And by having said so, I will already switch to English, because the whole evening shall be in English, so that we all do understand each other. My name is Kirsten Maas-Albert, and I'm heading the Africa department here at the Heinrich Böll Foundation. It is indeed with great pleasure that we're able to welcome you all, and I'm truly delighted that so many of you found their way into the foundation, many new faces, which is also nice for us to see, to be with us at this evening event, and therefore to the opening of Spoken Worlds. Today is the opening of a series of performances that will be announced later in Berlin of Nairobi's and Berlin's finest poets, spoken word, and hip-hop artists. That's not my words, that's the words of a Kenyan newspaper, Daily Nation, phrased when last November the 16 artists lined up in the front here from Kenya and Germany met in Nairobi for a week of workshops, talks, recordings, and live performances to explore collaboration within the project Spoken Worlds. One result of it was an album with 16 tracks. I think all of you got a copy of the record, of the CD at the entrance, and we will tonight celebrate the CD release as well. The group continued its exchange and work this week, and very intense work, I must say, this week, here in Berlin, and workshopped during the past 3 days in this building, different rooms. And I must say there was definitely beat in the house during these 3 days. And we, as people working in this house, and many of my colleagues were delighted to get the spirit, see you, notice you, and sometimes even get the sounds in our offices, which are on the different floors. The Böll Foundation is also delighted and honored to be hosting the opening event tonight, and to have been able to support the project as such. Why the foundation? One reason is we are located with one of our offices in Nairobi, therefore we are interested in what's going on in Nairobi scene. And I'm very happy that our colleague from the Nairobi office is here, Katrin. Stand up so people can talk to you afterwards. Katrin Seidel is here because we just had a conference also. And she has been in touch already with some of the Kenyan artists before. Where am I in my script? I'm lost. And secondly, the foundation was happy to support such a project because, amongst many other things, we do promote arts and culture as a vehicle of expression on how society reflects upon and understands itself. Spoken Worlds, as a literary exchange project, therefore, we see, gives the opportunity to of an insight of both Kenya and Germany, and hopefully creates lots of fusion. Let me especially welcome the artists right in front of me here. Welcome to the foundation. You had a long way from Kenya, a shorter way from Berlin. We are happy to have you. And they will all be introduced later, so I spare you that. And we would like to welcome the initiators of the project, Olat Aden. Where's Olat? Ah, yeah, in the corner. Olat Aden, Susanne Stemmler, Susanne Stand-up, and Isabel Ferin-Agir. Isabel, who have been, and I am witness, very, very hard working in the preparations and putting all this together and constantly with the group. And they also had to bear us as donors. And I'm very thankful that you were able to do that. That leaves me to introduce the moderator for tonight, Priya Balsel. Priya will lead us through the evening and moderate the talk with some of the artists later. We're truly delighted, Priya, that such an outstanding author accepted our invitation to moderate this evening. Let me tell you that Priya, briefly introduce her. Priya was born in London and grew up in Nairobi. She studied English literature at the University of Bristol. And I would like to name some of the outstanding results of her literary work. Up until now, there, amongst numerous articles, there's 3 books, Ishq and Mushk, published in 2007. And now I have to get the years right. The second was The Obscure Light of the Heart, 2010. And the third one, Strangers of the 1602. I've read only two of them, but I highly recommend you read them. And Priya is also known already in Berlin as well as an activist who supports organizations such as the Control Arms Campaign and has been and is still involved in some of the political events of the International Literature Festival here in Berlin. So we're happy to have you, Priya, and I hand you the microphone and give you the floor.
I add my greetings to Kirsten's and say guten Abend, good evening, and habari ya Gioni. So welcome to you all. And I'm actually just going to now give the stage to two of the representatives from two of the main donors to this project. Something like this wouldn't be possible without the very generous financial support of organizations. And tonight we will hear from the German Federal Cultural Foundation and the Literaturwerkstatt. First, some words from Ute Schnell of the German Federal Cultural Foundation.
Thank you very much. I hope it's okay if I speak here because of this papers and changing papers is very difficult with the microphones. I feel much more easy to do it this way. Yeah, thank you very much for inviting me and for that I can speak some short words. Dear artists, ladies and gentlemen, welcome tonight. It's very surprising and very, very happy that you're so many of you. Intense, that's how I can put it. It was stuffed, but I liked it. I liked the experience, the pressure. That's how the Nairobi poet Ogutu Muraya describes the work and the Spoken Worlds project in an interview. And it seems to me, watching the film trailers, which document the work, that he's not the only one who feels like that. The words intensity, energy, vibe seems to be a ground bus, a leitmotif of this project. Or to put it in the words of the Berlin rapper Erko, I'm absorbing everything like a sponge. Oh, this is the translation I hear, is it? Sorry. So this, to hear that intensity, energy, and vibe is a result of this project, I'm very happy because I think as a representative of the foundation, I can say that this kind of that it's not self-evident that artistic cooperation work out that well. It is, I think, poetically, intellectually, and culturally every time a new an experiment to enter unknown artistic territory. 16 spoken word artists, poets, rappers, MCs. 8 from Berlin, 8 from Nairobi, have engaged into a common exploration of new words and new worlds. Tonight, with the release of the album and for the next 4 days, we may join the exploration. We can see and hear where this intercontinental spoken journey, this Afropean poetic hip-hop laboratory, has taken them to. It's great, and we are very happy that one of the results is an album. Precisely because spoken word poetry is a life art or an ephemeral art, an album is important as a sonic archive to maintain the voices, the language, and stories for future interpretation and for future artists and for the discipline, of course. Isabel allowed me to already listen to some tracks of the album, and it seems to me, you might correct me, but it's been a lustful and a serious journey. Apart from thrilling formal experiments of blending poetry and rap, rhythm and silence, the tracks reflect a broad range of topics. From very personal stories of, I would call it, otherness, and the pleasures of riding a wild pig, to social and gender questions, and to, of course, declarations of love to Nairobi and to hip-hop. However, to me it seems as if a common thread that runs through all of the tracks is a strong feeling of disquiet at the contradictions, the injustices, and the distortions of nowadays lives, be it in Nairobi or be it in Berlin. And the feeling and the urgent need to change the situation or even somehow to improve the situation. To me, the album shows that we need this kind of artistic drilling in the innards of a city to make urban lives in Berlin and Nairobi concrete and palpable. In one of the film interviews I was referring to earlier, the Nairobi poet Wanchiku, oh, now, where is she? Maura says, now I quote, "It's been a growing process, but it's not just about the art I do, but more about getting out of your comfort zone into an art form that you've never tried before or never thought of trying before. This is exactly what we were interested in and still are interested in when we're starting the Africa program of the German Cultural Foundation and the Turn Fund. We want to get cultural institutions in Germany out of their curational and artistic comfort zones. We want to encourage institutions to pay attention to the artistic departures and artistic productions on the African continent, because we feel there's no way around Africa if you want to approach the contemporary arts from a global perspective. And we need more institutions and projects who are willing to dismiss the Western Europe, US-American fixation and face this new global reality." In our next magazine, we will publish an interview with the Nigerian-born director of the Haus der Kunst in München, Okwi Enveso. In that interview, Enveso talks about two simple representations of Africa in the art, in the media, but as well in the arts, and the role artists and intellectuals can play when it comes to dissolving wrong ideas of Africanity and telling stories from a different perspective. Asked whether institutions in Germany need new inspiration and approaches, he answers, "Break the mold, escape the comfort of uniformity, reject the monocultures of whiteness." Ich sage es nochmal auf Deutsch, man muss mit der Tradition brechen, den Komfort der Einheitlichkeit entfliehen, die weiße Monokultur zurückweisen. That's how I felt, actually. It's a very powerful appeal. And I think that the Literaturwerkstatt and the project Spoken Worlds and their partners show that this is possible and how to go about with it to do that. They give the direction to hopefully a lot more projects of this kind. The only thing I can do is thank everybody to make this project possible, for their trust, for their curiosity and for their endurance into this project. Thank you for your attention. And now I think I hand over to Christiane Lange from the Literaturwerkstatt. Thank you very much.
Yeah. Oh, wie gut gefüllt. I would like to continue in German, if you allow, because we have a wonderful interpreter and her English is much more better than mine's. And to say it with Josefine, one of the spoken word artists, if you don't understand it, feel it. Herzlich willkommen allen, Ihnen allen und herzlich willkommen den Künstlern aus Nairobi und Berlin, die sich auf dieses Abenteuer eingelassen haben, miteinander zu arbeiten. Und das waren ja und sind immer noch immerhin 16. Und warum haben wir, die Literaturwerkstatt Berlin, diesen Vorschlag von Isabel Ferin-Aguirre und ihren Kollegen Susanne Stemmler und Olat Eden aufgenommen und ihn gerne mitgetragen? Die Literaturwerkstatt Berlin realisiert seit mehr als 20 Jahren Projekte rund um die Poesie. Dafür steht nicht nur unser Monatsprogramm, auch das Poesiefestival oder das Zebra Poetry Film Festival. Und mit dem Weltarchiv der Dichtung, mit lyricline.org, haben wir seit sehr vielen Jahren eine Möglichkeit geschaffen, überall auf der Welt sehr schnell auf Dichtung zuzugreifen, über 900 Dichter in 58 Sprachen zu hören. Und auch dieses Projekt hat sich in den letzten 10 Jahren sehr stark hin zum afrikanischen Kontinent geöffnet. Wir sind also voller guten Muts und haben viele Erfahrungen mit großen internationalen Projekten, aber auch mit Projekten, die mit Übersetzungen arbeiten, die Dichter aus verschiedenen Sprachen zusammenbringen, sie mehrere Tage miteinander arbeiten lassen, in einem sehr intimen Rahmen, die Geschichten hinter den Texten sich erzählen lassen und was dabei herauskommt, sind poetisch überzeugende Übersetzungen. Und dieses Muster wurde hier angewandt und verwandelt und steht für unser Bestreben der Grenzüberschreitung nicht allein geografischer Art, sondern auch von Genres und Kunstgattung. Und diese Gemengelage kam eben dieser Vorschlag, nicht allein Rap und Hip-Hop in zwei Sprachen aus zwei Ländern zusammenzubringen, nicht allein Künstler einer Sparte von zwei Kontinenten zusammenzubringen, sondern auch Rapper, Spoken Word Artists mit Dichtern zusammenarbeiten zu lassen, sie Gemeinsames finden zu lassen. Und im Juli 2013 war ich Teil der Berliner Gruppe, die nach Nairobi reiste, um das Projekt Spoken Words dort vorzubereiten. Und ich möchte hier den Partnern dort vor Ort, sie sind doch hier, Billy von Kwani, MCK von Maono Group, danken, dass sie diesen Vorschlag so schnell aufgegriffen haben und mit uns gemeinsam realisiert haben, für das Vertrauen auch von dieser Seite. Und ich glaube, was uns zusammenbringt, ist die Überzeugung, dass das Wort Berge versetzen kann. Und wenn es schon nicht Berge versetzen kann, dann vielleicht die poetische Kontinentaldrift vorantreibt und beschleunigt. Was hat mich dort in Nairobi, als wir dort gearbeitet haben, am meisten beeindruckt? Vielleicht die Beharrlichkeit, mit der die Kollegen dort arbeiten, mit der MCK in der Maono Group arbeitet, mit Jugendlichen in Dandora unter Umständen, die ich nicht wage zu beschreiben. Sie können es im Internet, googeln Sie Dandora, dann sehen Sie es, mit welcher Beharrlichkeit Sie dort arbeiten und wie Kwani Trust arbeitet. Die Bücher sind überall in der Stadt zu finden. Sie sind ein sehr bekannter Veranstalter und Verlag geworden. Und gerade für Maono freut es mich sehr, dass wir am Samstag im Lido das Benefizkonzert haben. Gehen Sie hin. Gehen Sie hin, unterstützen Sie das Projekt. Wir sind überzeugt davon, dass es eine gute Arbeit ist und tun das gern. Davor aber, vor diesem Samstag, gibt es also mit den Künstlern, die seit 4 Tagen in Berlin arbeiten, Programm. Morgen in der Literaturwerkstatt geht es um die Übersetzungen und die gemeinsame Arbeit, um das, was hinter den Texten ist, wie haben sie gearbeitet. Und am Freitag in der Werkstatt der Kulturen dann eine Diskussion um Kultur als Brücke oder welche Rolle spielen Künstlerinnen und Künstler im Kulturaustausch. Samstag das Lido. Sie können jeden Abend kommen, es gibt jeden Abend was anderes. Danken möchte ich von ganzem Herzen Kwani Trust und Maono Cultural Group in Nairobi, auch dem Goethe-Institut, das uns dort beherbergt hat. Dem Turnfonds der Kulturstiftung des Bundes, der Heinrich-Böll-Stiftung, ganz besonders auch für die Gastfreundschaft hier in diesem Haus. Ich glaube, alle haben sich sehr wohl gefühlt. Es war sehr großzügig von der Böll-Stiftung, uns hier das Projekt zu beherbergen. Ich danke dem Goethe-Institut, dem Auswärtigen Amt und Gengwe e.V. und dem Medienpartner Afrika Venir. Sie sehen, es sind eine Menge Partner und es ist ein wirklich komplexes und aufwendiges Projekt und ohne sie wäre das nicht möglich gewesen. Ich danke der Dolmetscherin des Abends, Niki Kladura von Echo Konferenz Dolmetschen. Und auch ich danke ganz besonders dem Team von Spoken Words, Susanne Stemmler, Olat Eden und Isabel. Es kann ruhig noch einen Applaus geben. Komplexe Projekte, gerade Künstlerbegegnungen, sind ein Born von Anekdoten. Und eine meiner schönsten Erinnerungen in Nairobi ist, man sitzt beim Frühstück und auch beim Frühstück, werden Sie gleich hören, werden schon lebhafte Diskussionen geführt. Und einer der Teilnehmer, der Dichter, spricht über Versmaße, das Metrum und es geht um Jamben, Fünffüßige, um Alexandriner und es herrscht so ein bisschen, an einem Teil des Tisches, so ein bisschen Unsicherheit, bis die erlösende Bemerkung eines Rappers kommt. Ach, du meinst den Beat? In diesem Sinne, vielleicht war das der Beginn einer wunderbaren Freundschaft. Was daraus geworden ist, sehen wir ab jetzt. Danke.
Thank you. I was at the foundation here yesterday for a short while, and we were discussing this evening's program, and we kept coming up with different words for the performances: rap, spoken word, musical delivery. And at one point, Isabel Ferenagir said, "It's all poetry. It's all just poetry." And so this is an evening that will challenge and expand your understanding of poetry. The artists you'll see are engaged in an attempt, which is the attempt of all art, to invent new definitions and yet to escape definition, to identify a mode of belonging and yet to remain free. Language cannot cage me, Wanjiku Maruwa asserts in her piece on track 2 of the Spoken World CD. She insists on remaining uncontained, undetained. It seems there are no conclusive answers, just a journey that we're all invited to share. We start that journey now with a short performance by Wanjiku and Josefina Bergholz. The two would like to come up. I just tell you a couple of words about both of them. So the Kenyan spoken word artist Wanjiku Maruwa is also a published poet and playwright. She actively mentors other upcoming artists and is involved in awareness raising campaigns for cerebral palsy. Josefina Bergholz was born in the US and grew up in central Franconia and Berlin. She's been writing since she could hold a pen and has already won acclaim and awards for poetry and spoken word performances. Please welcome the two of them now.
Thank you. Die Hochhäuser wachsen mir über den Kopf. Platzregen packt mich im Nacken und drückt mich in Richtung Beton, die Lichtschläge, Häuserfassaden. Ich nähe und ein Ping-Pong-Geschoss ohne Richtwert bin winzig zerfasert. Szenenwechsel. Die Stimmen verhaspeln sich. Blind bin verkapselt, ich taste mich weiter nach vorn. Von oben gesehen bin ich weglos versandet. Randloses Kind in den Wind gestreut, haltlos. Szenenwechsel. Halt bloß das bisschen fest. Das Stückchen Heimat in eine Faust gepresst. Das bisschen Schreien und Angst in Applaus gesteckt. Begegne mir mit entblößtem Gesicht und ich leg meine Adern frei. Und ich schwöre, ich bin ehrlich, bitte schon dich nicht. And that moment,
the world shrinks into a dice. I carefully roll in my palm.
Matune matumanu. It's dark beneath the cover of my eyelids. I smell the scintillating smell of the massive freedom. Skin tightly, eyes closed. A fake sense of freedom, false security, privacy even. And slowly, I allow myself to contour to the pain within, hold a sub-session at atrocities I think thrown at me. All I see is pain, all I feel is pain. Then, bam, squinting, me crouching. Lights, camera, action, it's my turn now to speak, to stand astride Venus and Mars and bend over the darkness without. Because in that moment,
the world shrinks into a dice. I carefully roll in my palm.
So let me throw it then. And I will watch as it swirls on the table, painfully slow, wie jede Bewegung sich ausrenkt, a constant threat to fall. I constantly beg you to fall. What if that darkness of yours knows no bottom? No ground you could break your bones on, jump then.
Open them. Your eyes. Knock gently on the crust of your cocoon. Let it thrust you out. Break down the facade and roll it. Roll it on its tip. Create a musical beat as it skids closer to you, further from the flameless child. Just watch as the skyscrapers tumble. Rise from the concrete and cast your dice. Just roll it.
I'll meet you with a naked face.
Yes, beuge mich über den Rand, die Fassade am Bröckeln, der kalt weiß, wie die Finger ich geschehe, Satz, Einwand. Compress it.
To the size of a dice.
Lean in. Throw.
Now, to give us some more background to the Spoken Worlds project, we'll hear from three people who've been very, very involved with the project. You've already been introduced to two of them briefly, but you'll now hear a bit more from Susanna Stemler, Olad Aden, and MC Carr. And I'll just tell you a bit about each of them before they step on stage. So Susanna is the artistic director of Spoken Worlds and responsible for the project in Berlin. She's also a visiting professor at the Berlin University of Arts. And as well as being a literary critic, she's written on other topics, including migration, culture, globalization, and climate change. Olad Arden is a German-American social worker, mental health therapist, and a DJ based in Berlin. He's responsible for the music section of the Spoken World and for facilitating the workshops in Berlin and Nairobi. And MC Carr is an award-winning rap artist and community organizer from Nairobi. He's responsible for the music and the educational sections of the project, especially during the Nairobi phase. Please welcome the three of them on stage.
Thank you. Dear friends, dear guests, Habari Zanyu. So, is Nairobi in the house tonight? Yeah. Is Berlin in the house? Yeah. So let me give a warm, warm welcome to all our artists, and I would like to introduce them to you briefly. From Nairobi, we welcome Sitawa Namwalie. Sitawa, please. Welcome. From Nairobi, we welcome Wanjiku Mwaura that we just heard with her performance. Welcome again. We welcome El Ness, MC and rapper from Nairobi. Where is she? There she is. We welcome Ogutu Muraya, a storyteller and spoken word artist from Nairobi. We welcome Poetic B, spoken word artist and poet. Welcome. We welcome Octopizo, a rapper from Nairobi. And Checkmate Mido, beatboxer and rapper from Nairobi. And Namatsi Lukoye, spoken word artist. And please give a shout out to our Berlin artists as well, which are Erko, Rap, MC Josh, rapper. Diamond Dog, MC. Elements, MC. Christian Phillips, a poet from Berlin. Welcome, Christian. Joe Maddox, spoken word artist and rapper. Birgit Kreipe, poet from Berlin. Welcome, Birgit. And Josefine Bergholz again. Welcome to you. So, it is our pleasure and honor to welcome you tonight to the opening of the first ever Spoken World Festival in Berlin. The festival is the outcome of a project called Spoken Worlds. This is a poetic exchange between Nairobi and Berlin, an exchange of words and worlds between Nairobi and Berlin, and in between these spaces, constructing new worlds by a new poetic language, between the different performative forms of contemporary poetry, which is classical poetry, oral poetry, spoken word, rap. I would like to tell you just a little bit more about the idea behind the project. In 2010 and 2011, Olad Arden, Isabel, and me, we realized a project called Translating Hip Hop at the House of World Cultures here in Berlin and at several German Goethe Cultural Institute in four cities. The aim of this project was to translate rap lyrics delivered in as many languages as, for example, Tagalog, which is spoken in Manila, Spanish, we went to Bogota, Arabic, we went to Beirut, and Kiswahili and Sheng spoken in Nairobi. This project wanted to explore the local appropriations of the global language of hip-hop and its aesthetics. In Nairobi, we met many poets performing between and beyond the boundaries of poetry and rap. Billy Kahora, the director of our partner, Kwani, a magazine for literature in Nairobi, will tell you more about the poetry scene in Nairobi in a while. In contrast, at least I had the impression, correct me if I'm wrong, the scenes in Berlin seem to be not very much connected. There are few, or there were until today, but there were few collaborations between poets and rappers. We decided to further explore the boundaries between the genres with allusions, context-bound irony, wordplay, a highly codified language, oral poetry, spoken word and rap have a revolutionary and transformative power. They can even influence politics from below, for example, during electoral campaigns. Hip-hop culture, with its African-American and diasporic roots, plays an important role in all this. Not the only one, but an important role. Hip-hop embodies social knowledge communicated in its own language. This led us to invite 8 artists from both cities to collaborate on new productions with colleagues from another country with different backgrounds, speaking and writing in different languages, working in different genres. This, as has already been said, is of course a challenge. But it worked out. The artists started working together in Nairobi last November, creating music-driven poetry. They worked with music beats and recorded joint tracks in a studio in Nairobi. After 3 days of intense work here in Berlin now, focusing on poetry, our artists will present their new poems during the following 3 days, and Christiane Lange already announced the events, to whom you are all cordially invited. Since poetry has an impact on building and empowering communities, most of our invited artists are actively involved in educational projects. That's for me the moment to pass over to my colleagues, Olat Aydın and MC Carr, who are specialists in culture and education. Thank you very much.
Hi. Before I say anything else, I'd like to bring up a person without whom this whole thing definitely would not have happened. None of us would be here today if it wasn't for her. She kept this whole thing alive when it looked like it wasn't going to happen. So please give a warm welcome to Isabel Ferran-Aguirre, please. I will come and get you.
So I have to leave because my earring is already falling. So thank you very much. Enjoy the evening.
Also, I'd like to acknowledge a couple of people before I get started. One is she was instrumental in putting us in touch with the people on the ground in Nairobi, Ms. Anna Yega. She's here today, and I'd like to acknowledge her for all her work on behalf of this project. And also the head of the organization that I work for, managing director of Gangway, Elvira Barrett, is in the house as well. So my name is Olat Aydın. I'm a street social worker here in Berlin for Gangway. And together with my colleague, Joe Mad Dog, who's part of this project as an artist, we have been conducting projects and using art and culture as a means to bring young people together, young people who ordinarily would not be in contact with one another because they simply come from different neighborhoods or have different ethnic or cultural ethnicities. And so we've been utilizing projects just to bring them together. We've been doing work with New York City, Paris, Barcelona, different cities in the world. And when I started working with Suzanne and Isabel back in 2010 on translating hip hop and now on this project, this was really the one thing that intrigued me to just bring people together on a human level and see what would happen. People that live different realities every day in their lives and who would normally maybe not be in contact with one another, and to see what would happen on a human level, which would then influence the art that would be created within the framework of spoken words. And I think that it has worked out beautifully. I couldn't be more proud to be associated with this project, and I'd like to thank each and every artist that's sitting right here right now. I'm really, really proud to be associated with you guys in this project, so thank you very much. I don't want to take up too much time. Part of me wants to jump right to the performances, but that's not possible. But I'd like to bring up one other person who has influenced me in many ways. I met him in 2010, and he simply amazed me because he does similar work than Joe and I do in Berlin, though I would never dare to try to compare the situations or the circumstances in which he conducts his work. His name is MC Ka. He's here from Nairobi, and I'd love him to come up here and say a few words about his organization and his work.
Hey, good evening. How you doing? My name is MC Ka. And I'm an MC and also a community social worker. And I founded an organization called Maono. And excuse me. Okay, normally I... Okay, you good? It's good? Okay, I'm gonna start by saying I started the organization called Maono, which is also a name for vision in Swahili. And also it's the letters is like abbreviation. So it says Miradi Anzisha Onesha Njia Okoa. So it translates to something like initiate projects, pave way for the community. The idea was to create a leadership project for the young youths in Dandora, where like a lot of youths are marginalized. It's a very marginalized community. So, and the best way to work with the youths was through arts and sports and exchange programs, local and international. And also coming from where we come from, like Dandora is like where all everything bad seems to come from. For me, living, growing from Nairobi, from Dandora, I know there's better things that come from there. And there's a lot of art, there's a lot of artists that come from there, and also different professionals that they don't dare to go back to the community and initiate stuff. So why I say initiate project is because most organizations which are around, they are always competing. But in our organization, we try to tell everybody is everybody they have their own capacity to become leaders, and they can start their own thing, and we try to tell them like you can create like since where they're from, like there's a lot of problems, and people have to take responsibility of their own communities and try to do stuff. Our motto is each one teach one. So we are not so hierarchical in a way. We try to, the young ones learn from the old and the old learn from the young. So that's the project. I'm gonna make it real short, but before I cut it, I'm gonna say like I met Olad and Isabel through translating hip hop. And I would like to thank them also for bringing, like making me part of this. And I was happy that I could be here and share my story. And also would like to thank the organizers and everybody so for making this possible. I don't know what I could add to this, but I could say in Swahili, or Sheng, I could say Asante Sana. And in Sheng, I could say Mzuka. I'm a VP. Yeah. Or Kulinesnes, as one of the artists says it. But mostly, like, I'm not a really good public speaker, but I'm a performer and I'm an MC. So I will cut it there, and I hope to join you in the other stage. Thank you, Shen.
We're going to have two more short performances now. And first up, it'll be Ogutu Muraya and Madog. And just to tell you a little bit about the two of them. So Joe Madog Bleaser is a German spoken word and hip hop artist. He's involved with a variety of music related street projects, as Olad just said, Gangway. And I think Olad's said enough about that. It's obviously a very important project for different neighborhoods in Berlin. Ogutu Muraya, Kenyan writer, playwright, and spoken word artist. He's performed internationally, and his plays have also been produced internationally in countries like in cities like London, New York, and Delhi. They're going to perform a piece called Window View, and it's perhaps the most meditative track on the Spoken Worlds album, both in its approach and its effect. The piece is over 10 minutes long, but we're just going to hear a fragment now. And I think perhaps we should keep in mind Ogutu's perceptive question, which comes up during the piece, a question about the view. What do I choose to see? Please come up now for your performance.
So just a little warning, the extract is pretty long. Actually, just cut out a couple of words, okay?
Der Bus schleicht, Schrittgeschwindigkeit, hält den Kurs, nie im Leerlauf, immer den Gang drin, den Fuß allzeit bereit auf dem Gas. Man kann ja nie wissen. Fensterblick auf Ostafrika. Zu ihrer Rechten sehen sie Wellblech, Plastiktüten, Müll, darauf spielende Kinder. Zur Linken das, was es bedeutet, zumindest teilweise. Und die Spiegelung unserer frisch rasierten Visagen im Fensterglas legt sich wie ein Schleier über alles. Und wir machen Fotos, leicht verwackelt, weil während der Fahrt geschossen. Bloß nicht stehen bleiben. Zwei Hände halten ein iPad zwischen Augen und Außenwelt, ein Interface, das uns einen Rahmen für die Bilder schenkt. Man serviert uns die Welt auf einem silbernen Tablet. Full HD und doch nicht ganz so scharf wie die Realität. Wir verstecken uns dahinter wie hinter einem Schutzschild, denn ohne Filter könnte es womöglich wehtun, Sachen in Frage stellen, unbequem werden.
In my comfort zone, I zone out, staring at my window, like an art lover stares intensely at an abstract painting. I look deeply at my tangled world projected on my window. I study it like an art lover studies an abstract painting. I search in it for deeper meanings, hidden truths. It's all there on the canvas that is glass. It's all there. The pain, the frustration, the pleasure, the turning points, the fading background and the gentle strokes, the rough edges. I notice the colors so vivid, the use of mixed media so real. I notice how the colors change and catch the light. I notice the convoluted setting and defined images in a state of flux. I notice the lines, some crooked and others so clean and linear. My window speaks to me like a good painting speaks to a keen art lover. It projects my twisted world with its complexities and simplicities, where prosperity and disparity is intertwined, creating false narratives of virtue in poverty.
Staunende Gesichter starren auf die Scheiben und das dahinterliegende, wie auf ein abstraktes Gemälde. Mit den Falten gelegter Stirn und zusammengekniffenen Augen versuchen einen tieferen Sinn zu entdecken, zu verstehen. Aber verstehen es nie, weil das Bild immer nur das ist, was man in ihm sieht. Bestenfalls erkennen sie die verzerrte Reflexion ihrer eigenen staunenden Grimassen. Wie es mit der anderen Seite der Streibe verschmelzt. Flaues Gefühl im Magen. Ein Wisch mit dem Taschentuch, vergeblicher Versuch auszuradieren, was nicht hierher gehört. Schalt die Klimaanlage hoch, es ist so ungemütlich schwül auf diesen breiten Graden. Ein Schluck aus der Flasche Evian mit Blick aus einem Fluss aus Gift. Klappt die Fenster zu. Der Geruch beißt sich mit dem Geschmack von klarem Quellwasser. Zu bitter, zu echt, zu pelzig auf der Zunge.
With my bitter eyes, I see them. So real through the dusty windows of my apartment, I see them walking down the street's heads. Heavy as though being pulled down by gravity, faces downwards they turn, hiding their troubled hearts. Sunken expressions, evidence of long sleepless nights, eyes foraging the ground in desperate stares. As though searching for meaning and a sense of purpose, legs dragging along like blades of a tractor digging a trench, arms sway back and forth and back and forth, hands cutting through the morning breeze, so cold, even a gentle wind to them feels like a nasty gust. Each day turns dark and darker, full of unbearable memories. Memories of a slum where hope is trendy, widely distributed, packaged in glitzy wrapping, given for free, no strings attached. It's all you have, hope. It's all you hold on to, hope. It's all you need, hope. Well, entitled blue bloods fuck you in the ass and give you shitloads of hope to keep you going. Hope to consume like sweet pie, a slice of pie to give you, to keep you going. Hope not to ask questions.
Wir stellen Fragen. Und wir ziehen weiter unsere Kreise aus sicherer Entfernung wie Geier. Postkoloniale Vogelperspektive auf Armut, Elend, Hunger. Hunger. Ein Wort für zwei sehr verschiedene Dinge, hier und da. Das Stichwort Hunger sendet Signale ans Hirn, von dort weiter an die Hände. Wir kramen eine Packung Chips aus dem Lunchpaket, knabbern sie weg mit fettigen Fingern. Ein Finger zeigt auf etwas da draußen, das uns ungewöhnlich erscheint. Hinterlassen nichts als einen fettigen Fingerabdruck auf der Leinwand aus Glas. Der Film extra für uns synchronisiert, eingedeutscht, um es vertrauter zu machen. In der Original wäre es doch zu fremd und Untertitel sind so anstrengend. So ist es einfacher zu ertragen, verschanzt in unserem fahrenden, fetzen Europa, dem mobilen Zuschauersaal, weich gepolstert und klimatisiert. Für den Bruchteil einer Sekunde trifft mich der fragende Blick eines Mannes, der aus dem Fenster starrt. Kritisch und doch vertraut. Flüchtiger Dialog durch zwei Scheiben hindurch. Ein Funken menschlicher Kontakt hinter Doppelverglasung. Und wir schweben aneinander vorbei auf parallelen Gleisen.
Switching to second gear. A piece of Europe rolls by. Speeding across my window, I judge them. Privileged Mzungu peeking into my world. Maybe not privileged, just a different hustle. What do they know? Maybe a lot, maybe nothing. But what do I know? This flash incident makes me wonder. When I look through my window, does judgment fall of my sight? I ask myself, what do I really choose to see? Do I see the children blissfully playing, or do I just see their rugged looks and tatty clothes? Do I see the women giggling in deep conversations, or do I just see the buckets of water crashing down their necks? Do I see the men socializing with close friends, or do I just see them drunk on cheap liquor? I doubt my perception. What is truth and what is false? Which look is conscious and which look is ignorant?
Hint.
Who is it that I truly see when I look through my window?
Hinter den Menschen, hinter den Fenstern bleiben die Menschen Avatars. Anonym, namenlos, geschichtslos, austauschbar. sie für uns, wir für sie. Das Glas als Bildschirmersatz und wir fiebern mit, folgen dem Spannungsbogen, tauchen ein in ein willkommenes Abenteuer. Wissen, dass es irgendwann ausfadet und der Abspann kommt, das Licht angeht und wir den Saal verlassen. Vielleicht wird noch kurz diskutiert, sich ausgetauscht, die Bilder sind noch frisch. Dann wieder zurück zur Routine. Das Bild wird kleiner und kleiner, verschwindet im Rückspiegel, während der Bus in den zweiten Gang schaltet.
I see them through the dusty windows of my apartment. They start to disappear on the periphery of my vision. They look tired. They've been stripped bare, their victims. Along came thieves of words, bugglers of stories, arsonists of historical narratives, wreckers of identities, stories stolen, identities mocked and belittled, names made into fleeting things not tangible. Who are they? Who are they that I see through my dusty windows? Is my mind playing tricks on me? Is it a reflection of my faded image? Is it my image that I see on the glassy windows? Am I because they are, or are they because I am, so taken from ourselves such that I, them, we no longer see ourselves as anything else but victims? I'm thinking.
Ich denke.
Nawaza.
Ich denke.
I'm thinking.
Ich denke.
What do I see when I look through my window? Contradictions, paradox, absurdity, logicality. And we are made to live with these denials. We accept these contradictions as truth, brandish them as reality. So who is fooling who? Is it my mind that fools the reality? Or is it the reality that fools my mind? Is it the rich man who fools the poor man? Or is it the poor man who fools himself?
Thank you.
I'm glad we got the full thing. We're now going to hear Go Beyond by Elements and Wanjiku. Wanjiku, you met briefly when she did a little performance a short while ago. I'll just tell you a little bit about Elements, also known as Marcus Graham. He's a German sound engineer, producer, and rapper. And the artistic name Elements is highly appropriate since he's interested in combining different linguistic and cultural elements. Amongst his multilinguistic lyrics is the line, "Mach dich bereit für ein different mind state." So, prepare yourself for a different mind state as the two now do a performance for us.
Go beyond the space of time created by what you know. Beyond the histories passed on by revolutions they made. The evolution, the devolution of our cultures and fate. A lot of hate is peddled. Matirada tuedane. Marcus Garvey in Kuruma, mimi wewe tupendane. Gwatha madaraka wo, the madaraka mameshiria. Mental slavery is real. Go beyond the space of time created by what we face. Beyond the color of your skin and the language that you speak. Take a bus. Take a plane. Heck, take a nap and dream. Make a dash, grab a day, just make it real.
Befrei mich heut aus dem Labyrinth. Wenn ich drauf scheiß, wie die Zeit im Stundenglas verrinnt und ich drauf scheiß, welche Erfahrungen auf meinem Stapel sind, dann wird das Heu wieder zum Gras getrimmt. Vertrauen missbraucht, weil er die Karten zinkt. Die Lage stinkt, sodass sie mich ums Schlafen bringt. Was tiefe Krater bringt, das weckt mein Jagdinstinkt. Will sehen, wie er um seinen Atem ringt. Für mich ausgenockt, wie nach einem Schlag ganz Kind. Kaum Hoffnung wie ein Straßenkind. Vaterstaat soll helfen, Vaterstaat er nimmt. Schützt den Wichser und bestraft mich blind. Manche Regeln und Gesetze, wo ist der Sinn von dem allen? Glaubt ihr echt so schlechte Regeln, sie verhindern Gewalt? Will nur Gerechtigkeit, schrei mit meiner Stimme genial. Lass doch die Guten nicht mit so hoher Geschwindigkeit fallen. Er bleibt auf sich allein gestellt. Eure Waffen sind stumpf. Doch bewaffnen wir uns, droht uns Knast. Krasser Trumpf, Vater stapelt somit leider nicht zum Bruder mutieren. Ich werde trotzdem nicht die Hoffnung an das Gute verlieren. Befrei mich heut aus dem Labyrinth. Wenn ich drauf scheiß, wie die Zeit im Stundenglas verrinnt. Und ich drauf scheiß, welche Erfahrungen auf meinem Stapel sind. Dann wird das Heu wieder zum Gras getrimmt. Yeah. Yo, can I steal a water here? Can I steal a water? Yeah, thank you. I love you.
Thank you. We're now ready for our discussion. We're very lucky to have four of the artists and Billy Kahora joining us for that. So we just need a little bit of stage rearrangement. But if the artists would like to start making their way up, we'll have Sitawa Namwali speaking, Henry Ohanga, Josefina Bergholz, Diamantino Fijo, also known as Diamond Dog, and Billy Kahora, as I mentioned. I might sit on the end. On the end, if you guys want to take that. I don't know. I don't think you'll need them. While they're settling in, I'll just tell you a little bit about each of our panelists. You've met Josefina, but Sitawa Namwali used to play professional hockey and tennis, representing Kenya at an international level. She has two science degrees and worked for a time as an environmental campaigner. And these very different active tendencies, so to speak, manifest in her writing, where the content is often politically charged and the performance very physically expressive. Henry Ohanga performs under the name Octo Pizzo. He's something of a Kenyan slumdog millionaire story. He grew up in Kibera, Africa's largest slum, and has become an award-winning hip-hop artist who's famous at home and becoming increasingly well-known abroad. He does a lot of social work in Kibera, where he says, "Others may see deprivation, but I see diamonds." Diamantino Fijo, I hope I'm facial, was born in Angola, but forced to flee to Brazil as a refugee. From there, he moved to Berlin. His connections to Africa and Latin America remain strong and are reflected in his work as a journalist and filmmaker, but especially in his rap, which he does under the name Diamond Dog. His hip hop, he says, changed his life, and now he uses it to touch other lives. Billy Kahora is an award-winning Kenyan writer of both fiction and non-fiction. He's one of the founders and currently managing director of Kwani, which the name you've heard already, a trailblazing Kenyan literary magazine. Billy advised on the Spoken Words Project and was jointly responsible for the program in Nairobi. And delighted to have you all here to talk a little about the experience. I think the question I have to start with is, why spoken word? Many of you write in other genres as well, but what draws you to this particular mode of expression? And Josefina, why don't we start with you?
I think I started doing spoken word 5 years ago almost now. And when I found out about it, I think it just immediately got me by the closeness you have to your audience. Like, as wonderful as it is, writing can be a very depressing thing, because even if you succeed to write a poem you like yourself, you have it and then it just lies there and you kind of ask yourself what to do with it. It is a totally different thing to take that thing on stage, and as cheesy as it might sound, it is an incredible experience to see the look on somebody's face changing while you are talking, and when you notice somebody is actually understanding you and getting something out of what you do. That's sort of the moments when you notice all the shit we do might make sense.
What about you, Sitawa? Why spoken word?
Okay, for me, I think, can you hear me? Yeah, it's on. Okay, so for me, it comes from my tradition. I mean, I'm fortunate enough to have had several traditions to choose from, and when I was growing up, I had that quintessential African experience of having people telling me stories, so you know, traditional stories, and the ones that were the most successful storytellers were always the ones who could express themselves, you know, using their voices. You know, they frighten you. You know, they, you know, using their bodies and so forth. So, you know, when I started to write, I didn't set out to write anything that would be spoken, and then discover that that's what I wrote. So it really is that tradition, and I think very much what Josephine has said is sharing it. You know, I think poetry books are probably the worst bought. Like if you write your book of poetry and you think you're going to get rich, sorry, try something else. You're going to sell about 10 a year, okay? So when you create a performance, it takes the work out to people, and like very much like she said, just watching them going through various emotional spaces, various, you know, the facial expressions, etc., is really a very exciting thing. I love to watch people be moved by what I'm doing. Thanks.
So maybe poets have to become a bit like musicians now, where albums don't sell enough, so you have to go out on the road and really kind of, you know, earn your trade by performing. What about you guys, Diamond Dog? How have you come to spoken word? Why does that matter to you?
You want two? One? It's better. Well, I started doing hip-hop since 98. I was in Angola and was during the war. So, as many of you know, Angola had one of the longest war, like almost 40 years of war. And in this environment, we had not so many opportunities, not so many possibilities, not so many, diverse ways to do culture or to express ourselves, like to doing theater, for instance, or learn playing violin. So hip hop was one of the things that the first time that I saw on TV, people doing things that I could do also, I started really doing beatbox. You know what is beatbox? Like, and I remember I was doing this kind of things in the street when I was born and I was living in a ghetto, and many kids start following me up like Michael Jackson, you know, like superstar, like wow, how you do that? My grandma told me, please don't do it here in the house, because she thought I would have like tuberculosis doing these things. She say, this is my house, don't do it here. So, but I started doing beatbox, and I saw that many kids in the street, they were learning doing these kind of things that I was doing. And I had some colleagues where I was studying. I was studying journalism at this time. And they had more money, and they could bring this music from United States or from other countries. So we were sharing like tapes, was not CD, you know. We were sharing tapes, and I could not understand any word because I could not speak any English at that time. I hope I learned a little bit. I could not speak any English and I could not understand the language, but let me quote again, Josephine, if you don't understand, feel it. And I was feeling the music. And then when I moved to Brazil because of the war, I really start understanding what hip hop is. Because in Brazil, they speak my language, Portuguese, And in Brazil, I really met the serious hip hop that I could see in my life in favelas. People like struggling to make the favela or their places better and to give some hope to the people. So I started learning with them what hip hop really does. And for that time, I really embrace hip hop till now.
Great.
Yeah.
Check. Okay. Mine is simple. Like I was not going to do music or poetry or anything. I was a fan of music and hip hop in general. And back in 2008, there was this event in Nairobi. It was called WAPI, Words and Pictures, where underground artists and upcoming artists would come and meet. It was fully sponsored, free at a parking lot. So I used to visit just to feel, you know, like music is the only thing that can make a dying kid in Africa smile. Not even food, music is powerful. So I used just to go there and hang out. Then many people are representing where they come from. So, and some of the rappers that were rapping there, they used to rap about Kibera and they were not from Kibera. So whatever they were rapping about was a lie. So I felt like misrepresented. And I was like, okay, I'm gonna rap and tell them about Kibera then.
Billy, I might put the question to you slightly differently. When I was talking to Susanna and Olat, they mentioned that you had a sense that this project could be repeated annually and that every time there would be a new wave of Kenyan artists, you know, who would come and be a part of this. And I wondered, where is this flourishing of this coming from in Kenya? Why is this happening now? Or has it always been like that?
Yeah, I think creativity has always been part of the Kenyan scene, but the last, I think, 14, 15 years, especially around the millennium, has seen the kind of systemization of this kind of thing. We had a political regime before that, around 2002, that suppressed these kind of things. But even though it suppressed them, the kind of organic growth behind the scenes was huge. So I think in 2002, you see a kind of shift. First, you start seeing it through music, hip-hop, through talk radio, and then you start seeing it in the visual arts. And what has happened maybe since around 2005 is people moving away from the informal space to a kind of formal space, systemizing all these things into books, into CDs, DVDs, you see it online. And yeah, that's what's been happening.
Just picking up on that, what you said about the political situation. I mean, for example, I know in November last year, this bill was passed, which is really cracks down on the media. And in Kenya, I don't know how free you feel to say what you want and to sort of criticize, because as some people have already observed, the content of a lot of your work is very political. And Sitawa, do you feel you can say anything and not self-censor?
absolutely. I think that, you know, a bill was passed, but the atmosphere, the context within which it is passed in 2014 is very different from 1994. As Billy has said, you know, the political regime that we had was a dictatorship and did control very tightly the space. And, you know, I have one of the pieces that I wrote, I've written, is about that. It's about, you know, I started writing, interestingly, today I realized that I started writing when I went to one of the Kwani events in 2007, in March, and before that I was not a writer, I was not, you know, I was doing other things. And because Kwani had started an open mic, I went to listen to somebody whom I had admired from, you know, many years, and the next day I went and I started to write, and I haven't looked back. I'm writing, I'm continuing to write. And there is not the sense, you know, I grew up at the time when it, you know, the dictatorship was like a vice in your head. it controlled, you know, you, there was nobody there, you know, holding you and telling you don't do it, but you knew yourself how to self-censor yourself so that you didn't have the freedom to just, you know, sit down and write. You know, you sort of start writing, your hand would be like, I can't go there. You knew where you had to stop.
Was this under Moy?
Because of the consequences, yes. Under Moy, because of the consequences, because we saw people, you know, disappearing and, you know, getting into all sorts of trouble and having to leave the country, in exile, etc. So it was a real, you know, it was really serious. It was, but today we have, you know, all sorts of outlets. So right now, for example, we have, you know, stories, you know, on Facebook, Twitter, you know, all sorts of outlets. So it'll be very interesting to see how much control the regime can effect, although of course it can have an effect, but it'll be very interesting. Totally different circumstances.
How about you, Octor Pizzo? Do you feel free in what you can create and speak and perform?
It's not really, you know, like my generation and our generation is different, and for now, like for art, for rappers like us, you can sometimes you can get away with it if you really know how to put it on a metaphorical level. But we still, like artists in Kenya, still depend on radio and TVs. It's not like out here where like some Jay-Z just doesn't have to go to any radio, just post a song and goes viral. And no radio station, and I mean no, not even one, will play anything politically citing on someone. If you're saying the president is doing something wrong or whoever is doing something wrong, no radio or TV will play it. So that's one. So the only thing that, for example, I do, I make music for the radio, then I get radio friendly, I get the fan base. Then when I'm doing my live performances, I can stop my music and just tell the people, yo, this guy's lying to you. But let's continue entertaining.
So this is another advantage of spoken word, then, the sense that you can extemporize, you can change it to, you know, because of the circumstances, and it's an evolving thing.
Yeah, it doesn't mean like you should stop there. You should just use it on a different way. If they're closing the radio, you should, so that you cannot talk to the radio. When they invite you for interviews, you know, it's live. So when you've said it, you've said it. So
just to add on to that, I think. The atmosphere is, I'll say deceptively, like, open, but of course there are all sorts of sophisticated ways of pinning down things. But one observation one needs to make is that if you make a direct statement or direct attack, as Octor Pizzo is saying, I think stuff happens. I think the other thing is that I think artists do not have the same kind of mass audiences as, say, the political class does. And if you actually start getting the same kind of numbers and you start getting similar numbers of people listening, there'll be all sorts of systematic ways of shutting you down. Yeah, so that's, yeah. So it is open. You can say things, but you can only get beyond a certain, I think, place here.
Can I be part of this?
Yes, question? Of course.
So one. Oh, okay, just. My music, my rap is main political and about social things also. And from where I come from, it's not possible. I'm just listening to the story about Kenya, how is the situation, like that you have your own censorship, ship, that you know, okay, this is the border, I cannot go forward, I have to stop over here. And in my country it's like that, in Angola it's like that. Okay, it's one of the countries that most grows in the world, like, even Germany is not growing like that, like maybe 3% a year. Angola is growing like 13%. But if you see the situation in the country, you get depressed because the people are suffering with hunger and many things, many issues that we should not even have anymore because of how the country is growing. And when you write about music, about the political situation, you have to be very aware that you can die because of the things that you are writing. I have a very well-known example to tell here, to say here, is about one of the most famous rappers in Angola, and he writes about political things also. His name is MC Kappa. We have Ka here, but it's a similar name. They say the way how they say Kappa, Kai is almost the same how you write your name. And this guy, he wrote a song about that we have more clubs than libraries. We have more guns than puppets, like for kids. And we have doing this comparison on his song. And one guy was just watching a car in the street, and he was just singing this song that was well known and was not in the radio, actually. And this guy was killed just because sing this song. He was killed like was in all these small newspapers, of course, that the main one doesn't write about that. And he was brutally killed about that. So it's very difficult to do like a serious hip-hop and a conscious hip-hop in an environment like that. But we're still doing.
Well, actually, I mean, I noticed a lot of the artists and of you artists in some shape or form, either directly in the content of your writing or otherwise, you know, through doing social work, you are all engaged in different ways. And Josefina, I think you had some interesting observations going from here to Kenya and seeing the way that the artists there were looking at the society and commenting on it. Do you want to share some of your thoughts with us?
Yeah, like talking to the artists from Nairobi and also maybe also talking to my colleagues in rap music. I noticed there's a different way to deal with idealism, maybe. Because I feel that there's a much more serious belief that what we do can actually affect things that are happening in our daily life or even in our nations. If you join the concert later, some of the pieces are highly political. If you have listened to the talk, you got an idea of the content that has been playing out during this week and during the week in Nairobi. There is a strong will, especially on the Kenyan side, to influence politics, to influence daily life by our art. And I think most of the statements or some of the statements that I've heard during this journey, you will be laughed at for in German art scene, unless you're 15 years old. You will still be laughed at, probably, but people will forgive you because you're young. But there's a certain way of thinking that idealism, especially in art, is something completely irrealistic.
Why do you think you'd be laughed at here in Germany? I mean, for being too idealistic?
Now we get to the problem that the word pathos and is so hard to translate. But, well, if I knew why it was that way, I would probably change it, if I could. for some reason, I feel like maybe not only the German art scene is very, very careful with big statements, with big words. And there's a strong feeling that you as a person are so small, it is ridiculous to try to do anything because you won't succeed anyways. So people don't even try. And we sort of get into a very ugly circle there.
Yeah, I mean, it's interesting because when we talked about this yesterday, Sitawa said something which stayed with me. She said, "I am the revolution." And I guess maybe a German artist wouldn't say that, or you feel they wouldn't dare to say that, even if
it's so interesting because I mentioned the impact that Kwani had, open mic, on my life. And I was there when Kwani was started, you know, the discussions and the conversations 10 years ago now, over 10 years ago. And this journal and Binyabanga and the ideas that he had has revolutionized the space. So we have a different kind of responsibility. It's not just that, it's not like idealism, actually. It's understanding that the role that you're able to play in a certain sector and knowing, you know, it's like you can see the wide vista and know that this kind of change in this sector, like there was no other journal. You know, there was no other magazine that you could write. You could say, okay, I'm going to write a story and I'm going to publish it somewhere in a magazine. There was nothing like that. So Kwani created a space that did not exist, and has created artists that did not exist, and has created, you know, and now there are other, you know, new ideas coming, new people coming up, you know, that's how big that Kwani has been, and it's not just in Kenya, in East Africa. So when I say I am the revolution, I've created a form of poetry and performance that did not exist. And, you know, I'm absolutely sure about what I'm doing and the impact it's having. And I'm also absolutely sure about the responsibility I have, because it sits on your shoulders. I can't disappear tomorrow. You know, I've started this thing, I've created this, I'm like, okay, now it has to go somewhere. You know, we're only 50 years into independence. So imagine, you know, Germany 50 years, whatever it was, many, many years ago, when you were still new, as a new country, new community, etc., you still had to create yourself. So this is very, very much where we are. And it's very, very exciting. I feel sorry for you guys.
I'm interested to hear you say that you feel you're creating something very new, because I think that there is this sense with spoken word that it's contemporary, it's at the edge, you know, it's something really current. And at the same time, of course, the oral tradition is one of the oldest ones in the world. And I'm curious about your influences, all of you. I mean, Sitawa, you already told us about, you know, growing up and listening to the way these stories were told, and that somehow being completely embedded in you. But what about the rest of you? Octo Pizzo, what are your influences? I mean, are there literary influences? Are there, you know, other African traditions, your cultural heritage, maybe something from your tribe? I mean, what affects what how you write and how the language you use, the words you choose?
Check. I'm only influenced, like, mainly of, like, major influences, then I have like minor that I get influenced like every day. Even right now, I'm very influenced. But one is my mom. Like, I grew up with my mom up country, so women in general like inspire me a lot. In Africa, women, we won't lie. Nobody lie to you. Women work like two times men work, and so. Like, to me, my mom is every influence. Then the second one is where I come from, Kibera, because many people, like, when I was growing up, it was even a stigma. Even when I was in school, like, I wouldn't say I'm from Kibera, because we have this, there's already the way you are packaged. Every time you just mention Kibera, there's something that they see automatically. So instead of starting to rap about like how poor I was in the hood and how people are dying, I tend to rap about like what we have in Kibera that is not everywhere else. You know, there's many stuff that it's there. Like I was telling you yesterday, I watched BBC from my hotel room and see, yo, like these dying babies, and like send €2 to Africa to save these dying babies. And I always hate it, you know, like, it's not, dying babies, maybe they're there and it's 2%, and poverty is there, but there's 98% of people just working to just maintain that level of poverty. They don't just sit, you know, they wake up, they work hard. The kids are playing football. If they visited Kibera, playing, laughing, jumping up and down, going to school, you know, that's our heaven. No, we don't know any other world. Unless you travel like me, that's when you realize, like, yo, there's a different place that is better than where I come from. But when you're there, there's everything. There's school, there's everything is there. And that's what inspires me. Like, we don't really complain. We just don't understand. Many of the people or many of, like, the youth that I talk to, they don't understand on how to get out of their situation. And people think they always call it impossible, like automatically, like, I'll never get out of the hood. So it's hard to change somebody like that. The only thing you can do is change yourself and make them see it. Like, yo, I did it, you know? So you can do it too. And that's my motto. And I don't learn from like the professors. I didn't go to university, I went to high school, but I don't learn from like professors or doctors, because I feel like they always think like they know everything. So I learn from the people that I meet in the slum that are really ignorant, stupid, everything, that negative. Then I ask them like, what happened, man? Why did you end up being so stupid? So they tell me, then I don't do the other way, so I become the other one.
What about language? Because you rap in English and in Swahili and in Sheng. And so what influences your choices about which words you're going to use?
I use mainly Sheng. I'll say 98% Sheng. Because like my demographic fan base is, they only listen to Sheng.
Will you just tell the audience? Some people might not know what Sheng is.
Sheng is like a slang of made of Swahili and English and tribal words. And what's amazing about Sheng is that even Kenyans who are here, you know, they don't know Sheng now, because Sheng changes every month and it's different from every slum has their own, like where MCK comes from and where I come from, we talk different Sheng. So like you have to be, we tried even to come up with a Sheng dictionary, we couldn't catch up because it changes every month. There's a new word, there's something new, there's a new president, we want to make a name from him. There's a new kind of car, we want to make a slang. So,
and Billy, would you say that Sheng is somehow, in a sense, also a political statement to use that language, to not necessarily to reject the others, but to try and find another expression?
Yeah, I think so. I think because most of the guys, like on the edge of like political level, they don't understand what we say when we talk in Sheng. Like we can't even talk with my brother in the house, and your dad and mom wouldn't understand anything. So it's always easier also to say something that will just pass without them knowing, but the youth has like, and your fan base know what you're talking about. Yeah.
What about Diamond Dog? What about you? What about your influences? How do you see yourself? Do you see yourself in a tradition, or are you very much taking from what's around you immediately?
Okay, I think talking about hip-hop, I can say that KRS-One is one of my main influences because I like the way how he talk and what he does as MC. I like also Racionais MCs. I don't know if you know, but they are one of the most famous hip-hop group in Brazil, and they just sing about the problems that they have in favelas, about police brutality, because I really suffer a lot with police brutality when I was in Brazil. And all of these things, the way how they deliver these issues and how the things happen to them, like when I hear Racionais MCs, I can feel myself in these kind of things that they do. So I can say these two guys.
When we spoke yesterday, Sitawa and Josefina, you mentioned both of you quite different and surprising influences. At least they might seem at first glance. Would you like to talk to us a bit about those? You mentioned Pushkin, Sitawa.
Okay. I mean, I have very many influences. I don't think there isn't one influence, and on top of that, it's really also a process of growing and exploring other people, other writers, other performers, and so forth. But one of the, you know, I mentioned a traditional storytelling. The other influence that I have is actually, for example, English poetry. I absolutely love William Wordsworth, and I visited his home in the Lake District once, long time ago. I love Pushkin, absolutely love Pushkin. Then of course there's the African writers. I mean, Jack Mpanje, for example, from Malawi. Another big influence for me is African American writers and poets. Because very often they've had the very same experience. When I'm looking and when I started to look and ask, what is it, you know, trying to make sense of what it is to be an African black woman, one of the places I looked for these answers was from African American writing, because they were going through very many similar experiences, and some of them had sat down and really written and crystallized, and I recognized myself, my angst, you know, all that stuff in their writing, you know. So it really is very, very, very wide. Very eclectic. I mean, just for example, a German writer that I absolutely love is the guy who wrote Perfume, Peter Susskind.
Patrick Susskind.
Exactly. Yeah. You know, I remember waiting for that book when it was about to come out, and just, you know, being amazed at how you can use words to create smell and you know, things like that. Yeah.
Interesting that the things that maybe it's the way I asked the question, but that the literary references come quickly, because spoken word is such a synesthetic form, you know, combining music and movement, and you didn't mention that immediately here. Is it because one thing plays more of a role than another? Is literature more important as an influence?
No. You know, when we actually talk about, when we say the word spoken word, I'm not sure that I fit. Okay, what I hear when I hear people performing spoken word, and when I see what I do, I'm not sure I fit, because what I do is I create dramatized poetry performances that use traditional music, traditional musical instruments, traditional voice. So I'm really really interested in traditional music and voice and so forth, and that creates the soundtrack. And then there is the movement, and then there are the words, right? So, you know, I think I create something very different from when you say spoken word. And then, of course, I've watched other people and realized, you know, it is so diverse, you know, that we need to get specific.
Maybe we just need to say something like, talking of the English poets, you love Coleridge, the best words in the best order. That's kind of poetry, however you do it. I'm conscious that we're running out of time because we've had such a lovely extended evening. But before we finish, I just want to close with one question to Billy, because I read in an interview with you, Billy, that you're talking about how important it was for you to go away and to get a sense of how, in one sense, for literary culture to thrive, there needs to be a particular kind of environment. And considering that and thinking of this project, I wonder if you had a view on how important this sort of thing is for a society, for a culture, for the people who are involved.
Well, I say all sorts of things in interviews, but hey.
I know, I'm sorry to quote yourself.
I'm joking. The particular context you're probably talking about is, I went off to South Africa from Kenya for a number of years, and primarily I left, I think Sitawa said, Kenya felt like a vice during the Moi years. That's exactly what it felt like. And I think I went to South Africa, I was lucky enough to go study in South Africa. In South Africa at the time, in the late 90s, had just come from independence, and they were very smart about combining like new forms of knowledge and the past. So if you are sitting at a university in South Africa in the late 90s, the great thing was that they had taken all this history, and then they were putting together theories, and they were putting together knowledge to try and explain what the experiences were. Those experiences were big, but they were not that different from a kind of oppressive political experience in Kenya. So just learning how to take forms and formats and actually apply them to a kind of reality for me was quite amazing. And I think that artists coming over here with all they bring in terms of experience and coming to learn how German artists put together things and exchanging, not only like, I think giving and also taking from, I think is quite an important thing.
It's always enriching, even when it's challenging. Yeah. So I think we will have to end there. Thank you very much for sharing your thoughts with us. As we mentioned earlier, we invite you all to move across to the next room where we have a sort of mini amphitheater in the stairs where you can sit down and get ready. And in a few minutes, the artist will perform to you from the album Spoken Words that they recorded in Kenya last year.